morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to our worship service this morning. My name is Pastor Don Schultz. I serve at Lakeside Lutheran High School, and this morning I'll be serving as your guest pastor. Today we're talking about the church that God wants, that God desires. God desires that all people are welcome into his church, and that all people would be focused on his word. And so we'll focus on that today, this morning. May God bless us, encourage us as we focus on his holy word. We begin with our opening hymn, Christ is our Cornerstone. Stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins, and purify us from all unrighteousness.
Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Holy God, gracious Father, I am sinful by nature and have sinned against you in my thoughts, words, and actions.
I have not loved you with my whole heart. I have not loved others as I should. I deserve your punishment both now and forever. But Jesus, my Savior, sins with his innocent suffering and death. Trusting in him, I pray, God, have mercy on me, a sinner.
Our gracious Father in heaven has been merciful to us. He sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life as the atoning sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. for this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, in Christ, you bring people from near and far into the fellowship of your church. Open our eyes to your saving plan and move us to embrace all who seek your salvation so that we may rejoice together at the banquet of your love. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated. We continue our scripture lessons. Our first lesson is taken from Isaiah chapter 56. This is what the Lord says: protect justice and carry out righteousness, because my salvation is coming very soon. My righteousness is ready to be revealed. Then the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord, to minister to him and to love the name of the Lord and to become his servants, every one of them who keeps the Sabbath and does not profane it, those who take hold of my covenant, I will bring them to my holy mountain, and I will make them glad in my house of prayer. Their whole burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be acceptable on my altar. For my house will be called a house of prayer for all peoples of the world. This is the declaration of God the Lord, who gathers Israel's dispersed people. I will gather still more people to my house besides the ones already gathered. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We continue with our second lesson taken from Ephesians chapter 2. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace. He made the two groups one by destroying the wall of hostility that divided them, when he abolished the law of commandments and regulations in his flesh. He did this to create in himself one new person out of the two, in this way making peace. And he did this to reconcile both to God in one body through the cross by putting the hostility to death on it. He also came and preached peace to you who were far away, and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. So then, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of God's household. You have been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him, you too are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand. Holy Gospel taken from Matthew chapter 15. Jesus left that place and withdrew into the region of Tyre and Sidon. There a Canaanite woman from that territory came and kept crying out, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. A demon is severely tormenting my daughter." But he did not answer her a word. His disciples came and pleaded, "Send her away, because she keeps crying out after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt in front of him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered her, "It is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to their little dogs." "Yes, Lord," she said, "but yet their little dogs also eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, your faith is great. It will be done for you just as you desire." And her daughter was healed at that very hour. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The Word of God for our meditation this morning is taken from the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy, chapter 6. And so let me read these verses to you. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. So far, the Word of God, dear friends in Christ. What does it mean to be all in on something? And so I serve at Lakeside Lutheran High School. Every so often, a former student will come and visit the school. Maybe they want to pick up some transcripts or something like that. And so one day, this one student, former student, came in. And he was wearing a Milwaukee Brewers jersey, a Milwaukee Brewers hat, and he was holding a Milwaukee Brewers coffee cup. And he needed to pick up some forms, and so he went down the hallway. And then after he walked away, I just peeked out the window a little bit just to check. I thought about, in my mind, there might be something out there. And sure enough, his car, he had a Milwaukee Brewers license plate holder and also a Milwaukee Brewers decal on his window. And then he came back through, and he was about to go out. And I asked him, are you going to a Milwaukee Brewers game today? Because it looked like that's what was going to happen. And then he said, no, I just dress this way all the time. And then he went on to talk about all the different statistics and all the different players. I had no idea that there was so much information that one person could know about a sports team. Amazing, his mind, all that he had in there about the Milwaukee Brewers. And so I tell that to you because it's an example of someone who is all in on something. I kind of envied him because his passion, his goal in life, really was quite obvious and quite clear: to enjoy and to spread the good news about the Milwaukee Brewers. That was his goal, his passion. What about you? What are you all in on in your life? Maybe for you, you are a Milwaukee Brewers fan like that student at Lakeside. Or maybe you are all in on something else. Maybe it's your son or daughter's sports team. You wear all the clothes, you go to all the games. Maybe that's what you're all in on. Or maybe you have a hobby that you feel passionate about. Maybe you own every lure, fishing lure ever made in the history of the world. Or maybe for you it's your lawn. Even though we've gone through a dry spell, your grass is dark green. Every blade is manicured exactly right because that's your passion. And you are all in. Well, this morning I want to share with you this section from Deuteronomy. In this part of the Bible, God is talking to Christians. He wants Christians from all over the world to join his people. That's the emphasis of our Bible readings for today. And he also wants all Christians to be all in on his word. Is that you? Is the Bible, the Word of God, a passion in your life? And so this morning my goal is to encourage you, to encourage you to have the Word of God as your number one passion. And so we look at Deuteronomy chapter 6. It starts out this way: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And so this is Moses talking here to the people of Israel. They had just escaped Egypt. They had wandered around the desert for 40 years. They were about to enter the promised land. And so this is Moses' last big speech before he leaves them, and they go into the promised land. And Moses, speaking on behalf of God, tells them, I want you to be all in. And so listen to this. It says, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. And so don't just love God halfway, like something on the side, something at the bottom of the list of things to love. Love God with everything you have. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. And so don't just hear the commandments or the word of God and think, well, that's a nice thing, and kind of keep it at arm's length. Let the word of God get deep inside of you and affect your heart and your emotions and affect your mind and affect how you talk and how you act. These commandments, impress them on your children. What does that mean? Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down, and when you get up. And so to be all in on the Word of God means you don't talk just in church, but it's part of your home, it's part of your family. Talk about it when you walk along the road, when you get up, when you lie down. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. So back then, the Jewish people, they would tie objects to their foreheads with the Bible inside of them. And sometimes they would even strap little strips around their wrists and hands with Bible passages on them. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. And so this is a picture of someone who is all in on the Word of God. Now, when I read this part of the Bible, I have to admit that my conscience bothers me. Does your conscience ever bother you about this? Are you really that all in on the Word of God as much as it is described here in Deuteronomy chapter 6? God basically tells us, I want my word to be the biggest part of your life. I want you to have it in your heart, in your mind, in your mouth, on your hands. I want you to decorate with it, talk about it, think about it. Let it be the number one passion in your life. For me, to confess a sin to God, and maybe for you as well, would be this. Dear Lord God, please forgive me for not being so passionate about your word. Please forgive me, Lord God, for not loving you with all my heart. I love you with part of it, but not with all of it. Please forgive me for sometimes putting the word of God in the corner instead of having it at the center of my life. But isn't there good news here? There is. The good news is that our God, our Savior, is all in when it comes to saving us from our sins. Just imagine this, just think about this imaginary conversation that could take place between the Heavenly Father and Jesus, His Son. And so the Heavenly Father says to Jesus, Jesus, do you really want to go all the way to the point of saving the world from sin? And Jesus says, yes, I'm all in. And then God the Father says, my son, do you really want to? Do you really want to become a lowly human being, even though you are the high and holy Son of God? And Jesus says, I'm all in. And God the Father says, do you really want to be covered with all the sins of the world? Not just the small ones, but the big ones. Do you really want to be covered with all of those sins while you hang on that cross? And Jesus says, I'm all in. Do you really want to suffer the punishment of hell for the sins of the whole world and even die? And Jesus says, yes, I am all in. Jesus, your Savior, my Savior, he is all in when it comes to saving us. Even today, he surrounds us with people that come to us over and over again and share the Word of God with us and encourage us. He gives us his sacrament over and over again to tell us that he loves us, he forgives us. He never gives up on you. He never stops forgiving you. He's always blessing you. He's always taking everything in your life and directing it so that you can eventually see him in heaven. Jesus is all in when it comes to loving you, saving you, and blessing you. And so today God speaks to us. And today God says to us, I want you to respond to my love. Respond to my love. And we say, okay, we will. We will respond to your love, God. How would you like us to respond to your love? Deuteronomy chapter 6. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. And God tells us, put my word deep into your heart. Let it affect every part of your life. Let it be in your mind and in your mouth, and let it be in your home. Let it be how you work. Let it be how you play. Let the Word of God be a part of everything. And then on those days when we say, why do I want to do this again? Then God says, look at how much I love you. Look at how much I bless you. And as we ponder the love of God and the blessing of God, we respond by saying, thank you, Lord. I will love you with all that I have. Amen. Please stand. And now may the peace of God, which transcends all human understanding, guard and keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us join together and confess our faith. We use the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. We continue with our responsive prayer of the church. Sovereign Lord of all, give us joy in your house of prayer and open its doors to people of all nations. God, be gracious to us and bless us.
And make your face shine on us.
Your Son alone is our peace and has brought us peace with you, dear Father. Fill our hearts with peace in Christ and with our words and actions. Make us instruments of your peace in the world. God, be gracious to us and bless us.
And make your face shine on us.
Bring those who are foreigners and strangers to you into your household. Let your word bring dead hearts to life by the power of the Spirit and gather your lost sheep to yourself. God, be gracious to us and bless us
and make your face shine on us.
Give health and prosperity to all who are in authority, especially to the President and Congress of the United States, the governor and legislature of this state, and to all our local authorities. Move them to govern according to your will and to maintain peace and order for the good of your church and the spread of your gospel. God, be gracious to us and bless us
and make your face shine on us.
We give thanks for all who teach and proclaim Jesus as the bread of life. Give them strength to persevere in godly life and doctrine, that they may lead your people by example as well as word. God, be gracious to us and bless us,
and make your face shine on us.
In his earthly ministry, your dear Son drove out demons and healed many. In your mercy, relieve those who are oppressed by the devil, calm troubled minds, and heal every sickness. Strengthen and keep us all in the true faith, in good times and bad. God, be gracious to us and bless us,
and make your face shine on us.
O Lord God, at this time we also offer a special prayer on behalf of Nicholas Frederick, who is recovering from appendicitis in the hospital. Compassionate Father, in your mercy, you transform even sickness and disease into a blessing for your children. With this confidence, we commit all who are sick or suffering to your tender care. We especially pray for Nicholas. Provide healing and relief according to your wisdom and boundless mercy. Grant patient endurance to him. Help him find true spiritual strength through Jesus and his cross during this time of physical weakness. By the work of the Holy Spirit, teach him to trust in your forgiveness, grace, and love. Listen, Lord, to the thoughts and cares of our hearts. God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, govern and guide us so that we hold fast to him and have the victory of faith over the devil with all of his afflictions. Sustain us in all of our needs throughout our lives, and finally take us to yourself through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
At this time, we will continue with the offering. We give thee but thine own, whate'er the gift may be. All that we have is thine alone, a trust, O Lord, from thee. May we thy bounties thus as stewards true receive, and gladly as thou blessest us, to thee our first fruits give. Amen. Please rise as we celebrate the sacrament. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who promised that wherever two or three come together in his name, there he is with them to shepherd his flock until he comes again in glory. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. We give thanks to you, O God, through your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent to be our Savior, our Redeemer, and the messenger of your grace. Through him you made all things. In him you are well pleased. He is the incarnate Word, conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. To fulfill your promises, he stretched out his hands on the cross and released from eternal death all who believe in you. As we remember Jesus' death and resurrection, we thank you that you have gathered us together to receive your Son's body and blood. Send us your Spirit, unite us as one, and strengthen our faith so that we may praise you in your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we glorify and honor you, O God our Father, with the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory,
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen.
This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Take a drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins.
Now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior strengthen you and keep you in the true faith until life everlasting. Your sins are forgiven, and you may depart in peace. Amen. Our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior strengthen you and keep you in the true faith.
Until life and our last. Depart in peace. Amen.
Please stand. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His mercy endures forever.
Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup,
we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
We give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with this saving gift. We pray that through it you will strengthen our faith in you and increase our love for one another. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.